just trying to change the world here, people.
Oh, really?
Seems awful quiet.
The Facebooking and the tweeting and the Instagramming, all that would not exist without our understanding of science.
So it's amazing that you do that as an insult.
If you mean true for you is different from true for anybody else,
have yeah,
it
absolutely,
to
because I can't
prove it. Either got to be true or not.
I can't, no.
Ah, greetings, citizens of Netlandia. Welcome to ORLY Radio, episode 121, where we're going to wrap up our coverage of the DNC platform, and then we're going to get back to a fairly normal show. We're only going to do one show this week because I feel like crap. But anyway, here on ORLY Radio 121 for, well, recorded Friday, August 25th, 2016, where we're going to dismantle the current events for your edutainment through mostly rational conversations that make you go, oh, really? I have with me my usual suspects. I've got David O'Connor, and I've got Stephen Griffith. Welcome, gentlemen.
Welcome. Good to be here.
Welcome back to the pain.
Hello.
Now, as per usual, we are nothing if not human, and we make mistakes. So, if you catch us in the midst of a mistake, please do us a solid and correct us. You know, we got an email address, orlyradiopodcast@gmail.com. We've also got a phone number that you can call, leave a voicemail, or leave a text message, 470-222-6759. So do shoot us a note or let us know what's on your mind about things we've been talking about. We'll read them on the show, or if it's a voice or a video or anything like that, we will play it on the show as well, as long as it's not too gratuitous. So, before we get into the meat of the matter, I'm going to show you something that's not meat. In an effort to not be a fat ass, I am trying to replace some of my meals on the road, as I drive like all the time, with a meal replacement. I am trying out, in a truly geeky fashion, Soylent. Let me switch over to just me. Okay. So here's Soylent. It's in a rather nondescript bottle. It says Soylent 400 calorie right there. Okay. 400 calories. So now this is not Soylent Green. So it is not made of people. This is actually its predecessor, Soylent White.
It can be green with a little bit of food coloring.
It could, in fact, be green with a little food coloring. And to show you the real deal here, I'm going to go ahead and I've shaken it. It is chilled. And there it is, Soylent White.
Now comes in chalk flavor.
But it's not chalk flavor. As Ren, who is on the show occasionally, she was feeling a little bit low. So I handed her one as a meal replacement, basically. And she chugged it. And she said that it tastes an awful lot like Cheerio milk. Like if you've got a bowl of Cheerios, it tastes like that. I have so far used it for two meal replacements on the go. And I'm still here. I have suffered no ill effects from this. Whatever I have is some other thing. Hopefully it's not like Zika or whatever, because that's a thing. So, bottoms up.
Chug it.
Soylent mustache. Okay. So
now, if you cut that with some rum,
I don't think it would be good. I really recommend chugging it because unless you're a huge fan of soy milk, you are not going to like this. It's a little powdery, a little gritty. That's why it's like Cheerio milk. You know how there's little bits of the Cheerio? Yeah, all of that. That is the most apt thing that I can tell you about it. The nice thing is that on the box here, I got a case of 12 for $32, so that's roughly $3 a jug. On this one, let's see, so 400 calories, 190 from fat, 300 milligrams of sodium, 700 milligrams of potassium, 20 grams of protein, and 20% of vitamin A, calcium, vitamin D, vitamin K, riboflavin, B6, B12, iodine, zinc, copper, chromium, chloride. That's 15%. Pathothenic acid, whatever that is. Even 20% vitamin C, iron, vitamin E, thiamine, niacin, folic acid, biotin, phosphorus, magnesium, selenium, manganese, and molybdenum.
Molybdenum.
Molybdenum. Yes. So there you go. They do not recommend, and nor do I, replacing all of your meals with Soylent. This is a supplement, and individual meal replacements. You really do still need some actual food. So I would say at most do two if you eat three meals a day. You know, at least have one that gives your stomach something to chew on, as it were. So that that's that, and hopefully I feel, you know, all perked up. I kind of had a really light dinner so that I could do that. Okay, so so that was Soylent. If you have any questions about Soylent, I am not an expert. I am merely a user. I wouldn't even call myself an aficionado at this point. But it is a thing, and it's not terrible. I was concerned that it would be truly terrible, but it isn't. It's okay. So there's that. Now, gentlemen, I went through and I kind of I skimmed through the last many pages of the Democratic National Committee Party platform for 2016. And in all honesty, I didn't really find any major gotchas. It was pretty sound, you know, nothing really weird about the whole thing. Did you see anything that that needed to be mentioned to the masses? Call them out for some shenanigans, anything like that?
Nothing shenanigan-wise. What I found is, especially in comparison to the RNC one, is a lot of, here's the problem, now here's how we're going to solve it. Not in, like, inane, absolute detail, but more like, we have a problem with this thing. We are going to, like, raise taxes and to use that money to pay for these things to help this. I'm going, oh, look. They actually put a plan in there. I did like the hardcore backing of science and education, mm-hmm. especially sex education. I like the hard, and I was impressed with how long this section was, the very big section about native rights and treating native peoples correctly and giving them more jurisdiction and proper jurisdiction on their territories.
Yeah.
And all of that. I was like, whoa, okay. And they went hard. Like, we saw with the RNC was like, essentially, you have underutilized resources. We're going to help you attain independence by helping you utilize those resources. The DNC was going to like, it's your land. Do whatever with it you like. Here's some things from the EPA we'd say, but we think you can agree with the let's not poison the river.
Yeah, that's usually a good thing. David, did you find anything of note?
To be perfectly honest with you, I didn't have time to go through the DNC platform, so I don't have a whole lot.
I appreciate your honesty and candor in the matter. I wrote up just, you know, the bullet list that is available on our Twitch stream. You should, of course, be watching that. And if you're not watching it, well, I hope that you can switch over to the YouTube feed and catch it in post. You can see everything that I chugged with the Soylent 2 and all that fun stuff. But anyway, there's no real gotchas if you're liberally and socially progressive. In fact, there's some great things on that front. Policing the police, reforming mandatory sentencing, closing private prisons, generally being science-minded about many things, or copious pandering or, you know, swaying, if it comes to pass, to the Berni-crats. Most of the campaign stump speeches was in there.
What's the plan to police the police?
It wasn't major. It was mostly just holding them accountable and not allowing them to do it themselves, I think.
Yeah, that was...
Well, not allowing them to do it themselves is a huge step in the right direction.
That's big, yeah. So there was...
If Exxon Valdez had investigated their own incident, they'd be absolved of all guilt, you know?
I wonder why, yeah. So, weird. Of course, race relations, gender disparities, civil rights, voter protections, lots of the Native American, Indigenous American, tribal law stuff, all that was in there. There was also
calling out systemic racism.
Oh, yeah.
People were wondering, that's page 14.
That was heavy, yeah. So then there was the They did mention, of course, support for LGBT and allies. Sorry, there was no QIA added to that. It was just the straight LGBT. Of course, also fixing the broken immigration system, climate change, and they all had their paragraphs and positive notes of encouragement. Now, to jump all the way down here, the one thing that I really noted, and Stephen, you caught on it earlier, in rough numbers, I'd say that about a third of the document was just straight pandering. Or said very little or repeated itself. Another third was about basically comparisons and what they believe in. So comparisons to the GOP versus here's where we stand, here's what we stand for versus what they do. And then the last third, that's the big one, and that is actual plans on how to accomplish these goals. Sure, they're rough. They're not set in stone or codified in law or anything like that. But it's just like the Berni platform. They were all listed, and it's like, well, here's what we can do to solve this. It's not really that hard. Mm-hmm. We do this, and then, you know, that pays for this. We can do that. There was a little bit of the privatization pandering to religious institutions rather than corporate America. That's a big call out. They were calling for support of AmeriCorps, which I believe is a very big Christian organization doing world aid. I have not really looked up them. But there was also no chatter about school voucher programs. So
there was chatter about school voucher programs. I actually saw it in here. Okay. But it was all about,
let me remove that from my notes then. Boom.
Essentially almost like, there we go. There was the idea of, like, you know, we believe that high quality public charter schools should provide options for parents, but should not replace or destabilize traditional public schools. For those keeping along at home, page 34.
Thank you. Very good.
Charter schools must reflect their communities and thus must accept and retain proportionate numbers of students of color, students with disabilities, and English language learners in relation to their neighborhood public schools.
Wait, you mean actually regulating a charter school?
Well, that's exactly what they're calling for.
That makes it not even like a charter school. I'm completely in favor of that. Just don't let them get away with their own monkey business. So I'm totally cool.
Yeah,
with
I read that. And I'm going, oh look, that's how you do it properly.
Yeah.
So, just a quick blurb on AmeriCorps.
Yeah,
it's actually, you find it under nationalservice.gov. So it's actually a government run program.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Cool. That's good.
Similar
the Peace Corps.
Like
Peace Corps or something?
Yeah, it's essentially the Peace Corps, only domestic.
Okay, cool. Also, while on education, the platform did add the A back to STEM, so you have STEAM. So,
yeah, seeing that, I was like, did they really do it? That was awesome.
So Democrats actually do believe in science, technology, engineering, art, and mathematics. Awesome.
Because art plays an important part in all of this.
It does. Otherwise, you're not as creative. I mean, what about Johnny Ive? You know, all that kind of stuff. So
somebody's got to come up with a concept drawing to make the cool spaceships of the future.
Exactly, because we don't want to just drive around in a Borg cube, though we could. But still, it's not cool. It's not cool, man.
No.
The agriculture industry was mentioned and continuing its financial aid. Whatever you think of that, they are going to continue it, subsidies and whatnot. But they were also backhanded by saying that they would there would be increased EPA worker protections. Unions and collective bargaining were very heavily supported and alluded to by the platform at many times.
Well, they're one of the largest users of illegal workforces.
So well, that's not necessarily illegal. If we go back to especially the way it was before, it was very much you got work permits, work visas to come over here, work the fields, and go back.
Right. That's how
that was the way it used to be.
Except that they didn't go back.
Most of the time they actually did. They worked seasonal agriculture, but then of course the largest percentage of the visas.
Yeah, the largest percentage of like the 11 million people that are here came over legally, went through the process to get here, and then just overstayed the visa.
Yeah.
What if there was a simple rider in there with a work visa or whatever ID, you know, green card you kind of have, that you're not allowed to send more than X number of dollars via wire transfer in a year?
I don't really care
That way they'd actually have to go back with the money.
That'd also be a very hard thing to track.
It would be terrible. Yeah.
jokingly, I like the idea. In actuality,
yeah.
though.
Yeah, it'd be impossible. I know.
Use your money however you want, man.
Use your money however you want. They're still spending it here. They have to pay rent.
Yeah.
They have to, you know, eat. They have to have a mode of transportation.
Right.
That mode of transportation has to have a license plate on it. So, I mean, they're paying into the systems. It's not like 100% of the money that they gain on the farm is not...
Is sent away.
It's
yeah,
not
that's
all
not
getting
true.
Wire transferred out of the country.
Yeah. At most, it'd be like
it's
70%
like,
or something like that. I mean,
it's just like the whole, you know, election fraud.
Yeah.
It happens so infrequently, it's a non-issue.
Right, unless you're a Republican. So, in families, since we're talking about the immigrants and all that, those that depend on programs like SNAP and WIC, they, women's infant children, that they would not have to worry about those programs just evaporating underneath them like you would under Republican leadership, because they want to pull all of that. And generally, the whole thing was completely towing the Obama line and continuing his legacy in every avenue and likely advancing it where he was unable to, like with the ACA. The party states on page 34, page 34 was a good one, that they are in favor of universal health care, not the stopgap that Obamacare was. I've, of course, paraphrased, but in that
they're
section...
Like, it's a good start, but keep going past that, man.
Right. And also, in that section, they expanded on both mental health issues and also autism care for families. That received recognition as at least a commitment bullet point. Where they go with that, that's... Who knows? And, of course, Planned Parenthood, if you are... You know, a person that likes family planning, they would like to keep that as well. So essentially, this all says that the Democratic platform is a pro-choice platform.
What I also like beyond that is on page 36, still in the health section,
yeah.
They specifically say we will prohibit anti-competitive pay-for-delay deals that keep generic drugs off the market. And here's the section that made me go, really? And we will allow individuals, pharmacists, and wholesalers to import prescription drugs from licensed pharmacies in Canada and other countries with appropriate safety precautions.
Ah, that's a unique one to put in.
And
there.
I went, really?
That's definitely hitting pharma in the balls.
We've been basically banned from importing drugs from Canada since GW.
Yeah.
He put the kibosh on that in favor of importing them from, you know, safer countries like China.
Right, yeah.
Because... their quality control is better than Canada.
Right. I've ordered a lot of the stuff from China. It's not true. Totally not true. So also the national motto made an appearance. So e pluribus unum, you know, out of one many. Out of many, one. Sorry.
Reverse that.
Yep. I'm not feeling so good. Yeah, I'm not feeling so good. Anyway. So rather than just the Christian nation crowd that we saw on the GOP side, you know, it's more inclusive. At every level, this is a very inclusive platform. Gun violence made a couple line items, and of course, trying to get rid of it in whatever way possible. They also want to audit the Pentagon in an effort to reduce defense spending in a smart manner rather than an arbitrary figure.
I like the idea of that, but I think we've gone over that before about how
it's never
pretty
been
much
done.
Impossible that would actually be.
Right, yeah,
The only way to really rein in military spending is to simply cut the budget.
Possibly.
That's it.
Possibly.
They will figure out what's important to them, and they will fund that.
Yeah, I tend to agree with you.
They do have a whole section about ending violence against women.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Page 38, if you're following.
It's a very heavy pro-women platform, obviously, for obvious reasons. Not... the least of which is that, like, more than 51% of our population happens to be women. So, if you're going to pander to a large demographic.
Yeah. What I love for the preventing gun violence is the last sentence.
Go ahead.
There is insufficient research on effective gun prevention policies, which is why the U.S. CDC and prevention must have the resources it needs to study gun violence as a public health issue.
Very good. Now they just have to remove that law that prevents them from doing so.
That's essentially what they're saying right there.
Yep.
Is, yeah, we're going to remove that law.
Yep, without saying it. But, yeah. Again, if we read between the lines, we know what that means. Just funny that when we read between the lines here, we get something positive.
Well, reading between the lines here, and also in comparison to the RNC, we're talking about the auditing the Pentagon, the paragraph before that, now on page 40.
Okay.
The last sentence was, we will seek a more agile and flexible force and rid the military of outdated Cold War era systems.
There you go.
I think they need to rid the VA of outdated Cold War era systems first.
Veteran.
The hilarious thing is, in the next section, they actually call out the VA on that.
Yeah, Veteran Affairs was also front and center present. Of course, I didn't add it as a line item simply because both parties are pandering to the vet crowd.
Yeah, but clearly, as we've seen between the actual conventions and these, the Democrats are actually doing a better job.
Well, yeah, if you look at, I don't know, actual voting rolls as to what has been done, it becomes obvious pretty clear, pretty quickly, that the DNC, and actually many, many GOP representatives, have put forth bills for VA care, you know, and just all veterans affairs in general. A lot of that has been put forward, and it has been consistently knocked down or filibustered by the majority party. Mm-hmm. Care to guess who that majority party is? I don't think, you know.
GOP.
There it is. Yeah, it's like, I've got at least two brain cells, and they're telling me that. So there you go.
Just to back up just a second,
sure,
as a tactical maneuver, I would advise the Democratic Party to simply drop the whole gun control mantra. The cognitive dissonance there that they're fighting, it's not going to get through.
Well, the thing is, it's a vocal minority. The NRA is a vocal minority with a lot of money power.
They're a vocal minority, but they hold an incredible amount of power.
Right, but they're not
GOP, to the point where it's nearly impossible.
But they are not the majority.
That is so far uphill, it's crazy.
It's not that far uphill because they are a small group. The mass majority of people don't want more guns out there. There are statistics for this.
You know,
we've gone through them.
The vast majority of people want sensible gun legislation.
Right.
But when you put the words gun control together in a sentence, it is a Pavlovian conditioned response that everyone in the Republican Party starts frothing at the mouth.
Oh, yeah. They lose their damn minds.
Well, yeah. David.
It may be a vocal minority of the overall population, but that vocal minority is a huge player in the elections at large because only about 50% of us actually take part.
Yeah, sure. But most of this ticket, most of the whole party stance, they are at diametrically opposed ends.
Yes.
You know, so it doesn't matter if this is the whistle word. It doesn't matter.
It does, though, because it's votes.
But it doesn't because all the other things. They mentioned Planned Parenthood. Done. I mean, that's just as on fire.
Yeah, but when you combine multiple fires into one thing, it's like, I can never vote for that.
Well, they're not courting the GOP.
There are a lot of Republicans who might be on board with Planned Parenthood more so than they would be with gun control.
There's an awful lot of them that have used Planned Parenthood and don't want to say anything about it. You know, those numbers are there, too. But at the same time, you have to take all of this, and there's so many things in this that are completely opposite to their way of thinking. They are not trying to court any Republicans with this. This is a statement of this is the way we are, and that's the party platform.
Mm-hmm.
So you take it or you leave it. In this case, this is what they stand for. This is what they've stated that they stand for. So we have to take them at their word.
Yep.
Sadly, we also took the Republicans at their word. There you go. So feel free and go back to that one. After, of course, auditing the Pentagon, there is, of course, that little issue that we have in the Middle East.
Well, before we get to that, I was going to say, I like the fact they actually call this out. The fact that they mention, now on page 41...
for those following,
they actually call out about addressing the scourge of military sexual assault.
Oh yeah,
in fact, they actually call it out in the platform, going, "This is a problem and needs to be addressed now."
Yeah,
it's an entire paragraph.
They're not courting the red team. that is not happening. So also in the Middle East, it looks very much like we are going to continue our habit of pouring billions of dollars into the region, especially our ally Israel. And so, of course, with money also comes the lives of soldiers. That just goes along with the territory, unfortunately, because we're going to continue to combat ISIS and its existential threat of terrorism. And they want to also they specifically called it out to rein in Iran's attempts to eliminate Israel. Not in so many words for the eliminate Israel, but we know that they're trying to eliminate Israel. So. And that is that's all that I could really come up with for the party platform. My brain is spent on that. In fact, going through all of this has kind of given me a little PTSD about the whole politics thing. I want to stay away from it a little bit. I'm hitting serious overload.
Yeah, I was getting a bit of that too going through it. It's just it's just so much.
It is so much. I have hit my limit. Yeah. But you know, at least I have it printed out right here. It's next to me. I can look back and see what they're all about on both sides of the story. So take that for what you will. We have done as much fair and balanced as we possibly can without injuring ourselves mentally or physically. Then we'd have to go back to the DSM and then diagnose ourselves. So with that, I think, I really do, I think that it's time for...
If you wish to make an apple pie from scratch, you must first invent the universe.
If you're scientifically literate, the world looks very different to you. It's not just a lot of mysterious things happening. There's a lot we understand out there. And that understanding empowers you.
If you base medicine on science, you cure people. If you base the design of planes on science, they fly. If you base the design of rockets on science, they reach the moon. It works, bitches.
That's right. Science works. And it's done some amazing things. Now, we've heard before about batteries lasting an awfully lot longer. Your typical laptop battery or phone battery, believe it or not, will only completely charge about 500 times. Maximum. That's from dead to back up. Though, never let it go all the way dead. Batteries do not like to be below 3%. Just word to the wise. So they try to protect you from that, but yeah, they don't like it so much. So at the University of California, Irvine, they have stumbled into something that will allow a battery with using, nanofibers? Nanofilaments. Yeah. That allows it to charge over 200,000 times while retaining like a 95% average efficiency. Just kind of stumbled upon it. It was an accident.
Best science is actually usually found completely by accident.
Yeah, just like, oops, didn't know. How about that? It was a UCI doctoral candidate, Miley Tai. She was, quote, playing around in the lab and coated a set of gold nanowires in manganese dioxide and then applied a plexiglass-like electrolyte gel. Under normal circumstances, the nanowires are highly conductive, but thousands of times thinner than a human hair. They're useless after no more than 8,000 charges because of their fragility. They just crack and kind of fall away. But during the charge and discharge loads, in this case, it plasticized the metal oxide in the battery itself, and it gave the nanowires more flexibility so they weren't as brittle, which allowed them to just hold up longer.
200,000 times.
200,000 times, yeah. Now, this doesn't say anything about how long it takes for them to charge or discharge or any of that. This is just a battery technology, and we've seen the nanowire thing before. They got it up to like 40,000 charge cycles in 2007, but we still have not seen that come out. So, still waiting.
My experience
magic battery.
It's usually about 10 years before a technology actually makes it to market.
Yeah, it might be that way.
we'll be on that thing about the way they actually calculated out in here is, you know, this means that this new battery would last you roughly 400 years.
Which is awesome.
So as soon as we finally have that wonderful rejuve technology.
That'd be good. That'd be good, too.
Nice.
Okay, so also, science has been busy. And is now a possible vaccine against dementia.
That's awesome.
Which could just prevent and even reverse Alzheimer's. This is like, of all the illnesses that befall man, of the ones that I am the most terrified of having myself, that would be dementia and Alzheimer's. Forgetting who I am, literally just fading away in my own body. That's terrifying. Absolutely terrifying to me. So seeing things like this, woohoo, awesome. So scientists in US and Australia have made progress on the vaccine. It could be a big deal, of course, in treating this. If we are successful in preclinical trials in 3 to 5 years, we could well be on the way to the most important develops in recent medical history. Petrosky told 891 ABC that the antibodies in the vaccine candidate work like tow trucks, turning up by removing proteins damaged by disease, two separate protein potential vaccines, one for beta amyloids and the other for tau proteins, have been combined to form the new treatment.
That's completely awesome. And like, this gives me hope that we can come up with a vaccine for cognitive dissonance. Maybe we can start fixing what's wrong with the world.
Oh, we just got a note from Lisa P. Thank you for being out there. And it looks like no sound is coming from Skype. So that is terrible. So that's not going out, which means I'm going to have to be doing some merging later. So that will delay the actual result of the show. I'm very sorry, everyone. Let's see. Audio devices? No, that's not going to. Maybe? Let me see here. Maybe I can bring it in. Okay. Hopefully that brings it in. I'm not positive on that, though. So we'll see. Okay. Thank you for the note. Otherwise, no. I would have no idea whatsoever. Okay. So Alzheimer's could go away, which is fantastic.
I am 100% okay with this.
Yeah, there's... I see no downside here. So,
yes.
Now, speaking of downsides and possible not downsides, there was a research paper done called The Effects of the Patient Protection and Affordable Care Act Medicaid Expansions on Financial Well-Being. What do you think they found? Of course, you guys are cheating by reading it. But yeah.
Of course.
Well, I mean, you just put it front and center.
I did. I did put it front and center. Yeah. So, yeah.
It's our job to cheat.
No hiding it. Yeah. So, we'll go ahead and take it off then, since you're cheating. Or not. Okay. To put it bluntly, that as the coverage increased for the ACA, they estimated that there was a reduction in uninsured individuals, hence also a reduction in collection balances. They estimated the drop from around $600 to $1,000 among those who gained Medicaid coverage due to the ACA. And their findings suggest that ACA Medicaid expansions had important financial impacts beyond the healthcare user. So it basically made it more affordable to actually seek better care. You're in work longer. You know, all the things that we've talked about, all the benefits to having good health care. Oh, look, it actually works.
It's amazing how that happens.
It's about time, yeah. And I didn't add this one. Adamantium?
I threw that in there.
What is this? This is yours, dude.
Yeah, I threw this one in there. I read about this just... So it was published July 22 this year. They have created a super hard metal. They found this accidentally while trying to create unconventional magnets using titanium and gold. And they created an alloy which is 4 times harder than titanium.
Wow.
It is The new materials needed to be made into powders to check their purity, but beta titanium 3 gold, as it is known, was too tough to be ground in a diamond-coated mortar and pestle.
Wow, really?
Yeah. This stuff is hard.
Whoa, okay.
So, the applications for such a metal are so far-reaching, it's unbelievable.
Material showed the highest hardness of all tau titanium gold alloys and compounds, but also compared to many other engineering alloys.
Ooh.
Okay.
And so. It's it has a high biocompatibility.
Oh.
So
that's actually gets me interested, because that means, for those people out there who don't know what that means it has very high usage capability in medical implants.
They're talking about using knee implants as an example, which generally have to be replaced after about 10 years due to wear and tear. But with a material that's four times harder than titanium itself,
that is impressive.
If that simply translates over into additional wear and tear, you could go to 40 years, maybe longer, depending on usage.
So it may also have applications in the drilling industry, sporting goods industry, and other potential fields. It is a cubic compound with a particular arrangement of atoms found when metals are combined at high temperatures. We've talked about the temperature sensitivity of some metals, and you know there was like this range of temperatures to get something just right where it was not so brittle, not so, but it had all that flexibility and all the strength. I wonder if this is related to that.
Well, I imagine that this is useful for. You know, to bring it back to guns and military and stuff like that, this could be class 5 body armor.
Possibly, yeah.
Actually, it'd be more on vehicles and such, jets.
Well, you combine a thin layer of this instead of... So, we went over composite metal foams. I'm not sure if you were there for that, Steven.
Yes.
So they had a layer of composite metal foam and then a layer of ceramics.
Yeah.
And that stuff stopped an armor-piercing round, just shattered it. This...
that was the stuff that had to be heat-treated. That's what that was. I knew I'd heard of something like this. Okay.
Ooh. Yeah. So you can combine this metal with the composite metal foam and see what that'll stop.
Pretty much anything.
At less than an inch thick, it... probably have some impressive performance.
Yeah. Now I did not know, and maybe it was just I've never encountered it before, but I didn't know that bone was actually able to grow around titanium.
Mm-hmm.
I was unaware that that some of metals couldn't be grown around. So interesting. Mm. It's interesting. So that's just gosh darn fantastic.
Yeah. So we're one step closer to having our own real life Spartan program.
Nice.
Hi, Project Orly Radio Freelancer. Listeners. This is your host, Andy Cowen, calling my voicemail to make sure that it still works.
It's a bone structure.
Please consider calling us 470.
But the problem is, you know the essence cost. That's going to be
5-9.
I guess you guys aren't hearing the sound effects, are you?
No.
Okay. No. Well. Here is the Law and Order one. Okay. So things are a little glitchy on this side. Apparently, Google Hangouts updated things, so we're not able to go through Hangouts. We're going through Skype for video, so things are a little bit funky. So that also explains why things aren't going out through the stream properly. I'm not sure how to fix that, but hopefully I did. We'll see. We'll see. Alrighty. So... into Law and Order. I don't have much, just two items, but they're actually both around transgender people. So, the U.S. Supreme Court stepped in to the dispute between a Virginia school board and a transgender student who identifies as a boy. In June, a federal district court in Virginia ordered the Gloucester County School Board to allow Gigi, as the boy's moniker, to use the boys' bathroom in Gloucester High School until the case can be fully litigated. The a federal appeals court turned down the school board's request to halt the district court's order. So the school board went to the Supreme Court, where it found more success. So this week, the Supreme Court blocked the district court's order while the school board seeks Supreme Court review of the dispute. So the action means that Gigi will not be able to use the boys' bathroom when they return to school in September 6th. It also could suggest that the four justices and it also suggests that four justices, the number needed to review a case on the merits, could be willing to take the case on possibly as soon as this fall. So we may hear about that soon, sooner than later.
I like about this is the fact that, you know, we always hear, especially in the standard narrative of, you know, guys who are pretending to be girls going into the women's bathroom. And then you see here, you know, someone who is obviously born female, transgender, identifies as male, wanting to use the boys' bathroom. I love the change of narrative of that.
Yeah, you're right. That is a reverse narrative. I hadn't put that together. That's true. That's true.
That's why I'm here.
Well, good. Hey, we got to have more opinions, more thoughts on the matter. So, then next, a transgender woman robs bank, hands the cash back out so that she can then return to jail. This is a sad tale.
Yeah, our jails are not really built to integrate people back into society in any...
No. That's not it, sir. That's not it.
Why does she want to go back?
Okay. I just robbed the bank. I want to go back to prison. According to the authorities quoted by the Associated Press, Thompson had just minutes earlier shown a teller a cardboard note saying, "I have a gun. Give me all your money." The teller handed over everything she had, $16,300, according to KGWN. At that point, Thompson reportedly took the loot, went into the parking lot, and tossed the money into the air, handing out some to customers and passersby. And instead of making a getaway, she sat down and awaited police. The reason, according to court records, Thompson said a homeless shelter had turned her away and that she no longer felt safe to stay on the streets. She had suffered facial fractures after strangers beat her at the Martin Luther King Jr. Park the previous weekend. It is safer for her in jail than on the streets. That's why.
Well,
it's not about rehabilitation. The other people on the street need to be rehabilitated.
It does suck out there.
For finding a loophole in the law to allow you to be safer. However, it's sad that you have to resort to this.
Three hots and a cot.
I think that would be okay for people to be safe on the streets, except in the world where we just, you know, denigrate and speak vilely about our fellow man because they decide to be a different gender, which is an option now.
Well, it's not really a decision. I mean, it is a decision to go through with it, but it is...
It's the surgeries are an option. It's a legit option. And the technology is only going to improve for that. So we have to find a way to accept these people who...
But it is an extraordinarily
expensive...
They identify
as a different sex and go through the process of actually becoming what they identify with.
Well, sure, but it is also extraordinarily expensive.
It is extraordinarily expensive.
And somebody that is...
down as the technology gets better.
Yeah, but somebody that is in this position, they have no hope of ever getting that surgery.
Well, the nice thing is they also point out in this article that, you know, the number of transgender inmates exist, but they also report that, according to... Another show was reported in May in 2015, the Movement Advance Project and Center for American Progress reported trans people are nearly four times more likely to have a yearly household income below $10,000. In other words, living in poverty. Imagine, for everyone out there, trying to live in a house for $10,000 a year.
Yeah,
sounds like a lot of money, and it is when it's just straight handed to you. But stretched over a year, good luck.
The bank robbery is a federal offense, obviously, and is punishable by up to 20 years in prison and a $250,000 fine if convicted. Thompson faces a judge Tuesday, and her parole officer in Oregon did not respond to invitations to comment. Apparently, authorities did recover every dollar that had been tossed in the air. So there you go. But yeah, it costs more than $10,000 a year to keep somebody in jail.
Yeah, it's upwards of 50, isn't it?
It's probably right around there, depending on the region. But yeah, it's expensive. And for the people to be making an income below $10,000, honestly, if you can deal with the rigors, the government will take care of you.
The annual average taxpayer cost in the aggregate states, they did 40 states that were participating in this aggregate study, $31,286 per inmate, with New York being the most expensive at $60,000 per inmate.
That is more than minimum wage. I think about $32,000 is like right at $10 an hour.
No, God, no.
No, that's about $15.
Is it about there? Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah. Told you, I'm not feeling well. I'm not going to do math anymore. Okay. So that's the sad story. And yeah, so here's that voicemail break again.
Hi, Orly Radio listeners. This is your host, Andy Cowen, calling my voicemail to make sure that it still works. Please consider calling us, 470-222-6759.
And now, good ideas.
It's time for another exactly good idea, bad idea.
Dollars an hour.
Good idea.
All right, folks. So, in an interesting twist, a Unitarian Universalist church is suing the town of Bedford, Massachusetts, for denying a request to install solar panels on its property, arguing that authorities are infringing on the congregation's right to express their religious belief in a clean energy solution.
You gotta love when those little laws and ideas that they put, all these people put out there, say, yes, this applies to all religions. No, it's not just Christian. And then you go, really? Let's test that.
Okay, here we go. I do like the balls of the UU. They do some great things.
Mm-hmm.
So let's see here. According to ORLY-EP0121 Defense, the first Unitarian Universalist parish in Bedford applied for a certificate of appropriateness to install solar panels on its meeting house earlier this year, only to be denied by the town's historic district commission. In response, the congregation filed a complaint on June 27th based on the unusual argument that denial violated their congregation's free exercise of religion, specifically the First Amendment of the United States Constitution. So, yeah. The decision exceeds the authority of the HDC, was legally untenable, unreasonable, arbitrary, and capricious, and violated the rights of the members of First Parish to the free exercise of their religious beliefs. Boom. I love
this. This is a beautiful thing.
I love this so much. So this is a good idea. So, you know, if I wonder if we could do something like that here in Florida.
Again, how to properly use those things. Well,
how to properly use those things.
It's not that hard, actually.
No. I think the whole congregation, right? You know, we believe in clean energy. Therefore, I need to put solar panels on my house. I need to be able to use them to the fullest extent that I'm capable of doing to save the world. So I need to be able to feed it back into the grid. You have to buy it from me.
I also believe it's intended to commodify the.
You can challenge the law that says that you're not allowed to own your own solar panels. Those will have to belong to. Because didn't they get that passed through?
No. You can still own your own solar panels because otherwise it would be illegal to buy them. And you can still buy them at Harbor Freight.
No, the yes on one thing is coming up.
Well, there's. I gotcha.
And that's the one that.
There's four.
You only can do it through the utilities. You can't do it through anybody else.
Well, you wouldn't be able to feed it back into the grid at all. That is their big thing. Yeah, do it if you want. We don't want you to, but you're not going to attach that to the grid in any way, which obviously hampers the installation of what you're doing.
It also flies in the face of another law where you have to be on the grid.
Well,
it is a requirement. It is state law. You have to be on the grid.
Right. Well, you have to be connected to the grid. You don't have to use it. That's the thing. You have to have, you know, if it is offered, if you public utilities are offered to your residence, to your street address, you have to have the hookup there. Your usage is your usage. Mm-hmm. So you don't have to use it. They can't make you use it. That would be many kinds of violations right there.
Yeah.
But still, in order to have a system that's effective and works, then it needs to be attached to the grid so that you can get that utility power when you need it, and when you don't need it and you're generating more with your own appliances, then you can feed it back in and both lower your bill and help offset some of the grid's need. You know, it's actually a good thing for everybody. So that they're doing this is just a money grab. And that's the only way that I can look at it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So that's awesome in every way possible. And then Elon Musk unveiled his latest vision for Tesla Motors. It's semi-trucks.
Yes.
He's going to build big rigs. He's going to build buses. He's already got them in the works, and it's just a matter of time.
See, I love the fact that Elon Musk has figured out, like, crowdfunding before crowdfunding.
Yeah.
It's like, here, I've already got this plan. Here's what I'm planning on doing. Now invest so I can do it.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a unique kind of situation that he's in. But he's obviously proven to be a visionary in this field. Even with the single death in that one Tesla crash, due to the autopilot, which shouldn't really be called autopilot, it's driver assist mode or whatever.
Yeah. Speaking of Tesla, yeah. I saw the first Model X I've ever seen on the road today.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah. It's pretty. I want it.
I knew that they're trying to make them as fast as they can. They're supposed to be making something like 80,000 of them a year, or was it more than that? But yeah, his the Tesla blog, Master Plan, Part 2. He actually says it, Part 2. It's right there. I didn't make that up. I would.
Nice.
Because that's me. But no, it's right there. So... master plan that he wrote 10 years ago is now in the final stages of completion. It wasn't all that complicated and basically consisted of create a low volume car, which would necessarily be expensive. Would have to be expensive. Yes.
Once again, you're sick. It's okay. We
exactly. Yeah. Yeah. It's not to scale, Doc. I understand.
Yeah. You want me to read through this?
Sure. Go ahead, please.
Yep. Part two was to use that money to develop a medium volume car at a lower price. So first they created the Roadster, which was over $100,000. Then they created the Model S, which was, I think, 70 or 80, somewhere in there.
Yeah.
Then they used that money to create an affordable high-volume car, the Model 3, which is coming out soon, 30,000, 30 to 40, I want to say.
35,000 is the target price.
Depending on your options.
Yeah, base is 35.
And then the final part of that plan is to provide solar power.
No kidding. This has literally been around on our website for 10 years.
This has literally been on our website for 10 years.
I love that.
It's a beautiful thing. So then they, let's see, does he have his new
thing?
How
to properly be a villain going, look, I've monologued. Here's my evil plan. I'm literally telling you what I'm doing.
But it's
why
not
are you surprised?
But it's not an evil plan. Not at all. So this, we got the link in the show notes. You can read through. Elon Musk master plan.
He's more likely to be Ozymandias than Lex Luthor.
I'm okay with that.
Yeah.
Oscorp.
Yep. Do you think I'm sort of? You could just imagine Elon Musk saying, "Do you think I'm some sort of comic book villain? I activated it 38 minutes ago."
He's like, "Please."
It's like this monologue was merely to allow it to detonate.
I would have told you my master's stroke while you had a chance to stop it? No, not some comic book villain.
I'm just explaining what has happened to you.
Yeah. And actually, in the Watchmen comics, I believe that his Ozymandias' claim to fame was he developed electric vehicles that everyone in the world was using.
Oh.
And it takes part prominently in the comics where there's two guys talking at random times because the one guy has to stop and charge up his truck so he can continue delivering on his route.
Nice. Cool.
So he goes, hangs out with his buddy at a newsstand, charges his vehicle. They have a conversation, and he leaves. Electrically driven vehicle.
Beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, it's right here. Expand to cover the major forms of terrestrial transport.
I just love the way he talks.
Terrestrial transport. Well, he also has that whole Hyperloop thing going on.
Oh, yeah.
I'm just waiting for him to invent regrav vehicles. I want my regrav pod.
Yeah, regrav would be fantastic. We got to master that whole gravity thing, though. Inverse square law's a bitch. Okay, so today Tesla addressed two relatively small segments of premium sedans and SUVs with the Model 3, a future compact SUV, and a new kind of pickup truck. We plan to address most of the consumer market. A lower cost vehicle than the Model 3 is unlikely to be necessary because of the third part of this plan described below.
See, I would be willing to throw down, I would be begging, pleading, I don't care how I would have to get the money, I would throw down so much to get a Tesla pickup.
Yeah.
That solves both my problems in ways that I want.
Yeah. Dig the language here. A first principles physics analysis of automotive production suggests that somewhere between 5 and 10 fold improvement is achievable by version 3 on a roughly 2-year iteration cycle.
Yes, Tony, we understand. You're smarter than the rest of us.
Can you bring it down for the rest of us?
The beautiful thing with these electric cars is there's thousands of fewer parts than in an internal combustion engine vehicle.
Oh, yeah.
And with the reduced complexity, you are going to get longer running life.
Yeah.
It's just going to be swap out the battery pack on your used Tesla Model 3.
Change out the motor.
And as long as the interior is built halfway decently, used Model 3 is going to be amazing to own.
Yeah.
And that's what I'm hanging on for.
Tesla
engineering.
As
soon as we can get those 200,000 cycle charge batteries on a Tesla, we're good.
That would be super fantastic. So the Tesla engineering team has transitioned to focus heavily on designing the machine that makes the machine, turning the factory itself into a product.
Interesting.
He's literally pulling future capitalism.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, we have the people who are still modern capitalists who are still trying to pull themselves out of the robber baron days. He's going, shit, man, I'm already doing capitalism for 100 years from now.
It's like, this is my industry now. You can have it, but you're going to be back there because I've already planned all this out.
You can have it. I'll lease it to you.
Yeah, that's fine. Sure. I'll make the stuff that you need. The first Model 3 factory machine should be thought of as version 0.5, with version 1 probably in 2018.
Wow.
In short, Master Plan Part 2 is create stunning solar roofs and seamlessly integrated battery storage, expand the electric vehicle product line to address all major segments, develop a self-driving capability that is 10 times safer than manual via massive fleet learning, and enable your car to make money for you when you aren't using it.
Your car becomes a taxi cab while you're at work.
Sharing, yeah. When true self-driving is approved by regulators, it will mean that you'll be able to summon your Tesla from pretty much anywhere. Once it picks you up, you'll be able to sleep, read, or do anything en route to your destination. You'll be able to add your car to the Tesla shared fleet just by tapping a button on the Tesla phone app and have it generate income for you while you're at work or on vacation, significantly offsetting and at times potentially exceeding the monthly loan or lease cost. This dramatically lowers the true cost of ownership to the point where almost anyone could own a Tesla.
He just took the traditional model of mass transit and taxi services, did a helicopter spin, and broke its back over his knee. That's sentences.
Also, I think I know what's actually going on here. The more I read his stuff, the more I hear about his stuff. He's in a secret shadow war with Skynet.
Well, actually, he does own significant shares in a artificial intelligence company.
He's trying to make sure that when it comes about, it's going to be friendly.
Yeah, he is. That he's stated as much. His Twitter is an amazing treasure trove of stuff. So, yeah, he's I love this man. He's crazy in all the ways that I want to be. Yeah. So, okay, so we're into...
Bad idea.
Bad ideas. And, gentlemen, this is where we're going to get a little bit hinky here.
Hanky.
Yeah, now I'm going to play a video that you two probably aren't going to be able to hear, which is unfortunate. But the listeners at home, here it is.
I have to follow up with that, with it, and I'll be very careful here. Several months ago, a foreign policy expert on the international level went to advise Donald Trump, and three times he asked about the use of nuclear weapons. Three times he asked, at one point, if we have them, why can't we use them? That's one of the reasons why he just doesn't have foreign policy experts around.
Trump asked three times.
Three times in an hour briefing, why can't we use nuclear weapons? With that.
Be careful, America.
So, guys, I don't know. Have you been able to? Did you hear it?
Not a word.
No.
Okay. Have you watched it before?
Not that, but I've seen stuff like it's about.
Okay. Well, it states it here in the Vox article that Wednesday morning, NBC's Joe Scarborough said something profoundly frightening about Donald Trump. In a private conversation with a foreign policy expert, Scarborough reported Trump asked repeatedly, why we have nuclear weapons if we don't use them?
Yeah.
So, quote, several months ago, a foreign policy expert on the international level went to advise Donald Trump, and three times Trump asked about the use of nuclear weapons. Three times he asked, at one point, if we had them, why can't we use them?
Well, I mean, if you want to end the world.
And that's what it comes down to. These are weapons of mass destruction in ways that are truly mass destruction.
Beyond that, what gets me is the quote from Dr. Strangelove. The point of a doomsday weapon is to tell everyone you have it so you don't have to use it.
Correct.
That point is moot if you keep it a secret.
We was going to do it on this birthday.
Exactly. I love it. Now, some would ask, well, if he was president, could he just do that?
Yes.
The answer is yes. In real short order, yes. Because of the nature of modern warfare, nuclear warfare, to be specific, he is the one. It is the executive in charge, has control over what has been nicknamed the football, the briefcase that has all the launch codes, and all the ability that it needs to issue those launch codes. It is then up to the individual console operators to boot up their floppy drives and launch the suckers. Mm-hmm. It doesn't take long, and it doesn't have two-factor authentication.
Nope.
But there is one... Yeah, go ahead.
Nope. Carry on.
You're about to say, I think, yeah, the one... key thing in all this is the Secretary of Defense is required to verify the president's order to launch. They don't have veto power, but if the president orders to launch, they are legally obliged to do it. However, they could theoretically choose to resign rather than carry out that order, which would then fall to the Secretary's second in command. Basically, if he decided to do this, he would need every single person who could be in that chain to resign and keep it from being a thing that could occur. That would be the only way to stop it.
And he only needs a couple years to really put in place people who are just going to say yes.
He would probably do that day one.
Well, I mean, right. It takes a little bit to get those people in place and them up to speed. Don't some of those people have to be confirmed?
No.
Not the cabinet.
Never mind.
No, don't some cabinet positions?
He could do it day one.
I thought some cabinet positions had to be confirmed by Congress. Or, no, Senate appointments, weren't they? I thought.
Let me make sure.
So this may sound like a genuine hyperbole, but Ron Rosenbaum, a journalist who wrote a book about America's nuclear weapons, looked into Cheney's claim as part of a 2011 Slate piece and concluded that he was basically accurate. No one could come up with a definitive constitutional refutation of this. Any president could, on his own, leave a room and in 25 minutes, 70 million or more than that would be dead. He could launch a kind of devastating attack the world's never seen. He doesn't have to check with anybody. He doesn't have to call Congress. He doesn't have to check with the courts. He has that authority because of the nature of the world we live in.
And I have to retract my statement. No, they actually, the secretaries of the 15 cabinet agencies and their undersecretaries and everything else all require Senate approval.
I thought they did. Thankfully. So at least he'll be surrounded by people that hopefully have been vetted better than the American public has vetted him.
Yeah.
They like what he says.
But the House and Senate positions likely going to stay Republican due to various things. So,
incumbency?
Huh?
Incumbency rates?
Incumbency rates and gerrymandering.
Yeah.
Not likely to swing far enough to the left for them for the majority to change.
And voter restrictions.
So with that said,
all that.
He stands a fairly decent chance of having his picks actually confirmed.
Yeah. So the nuclear football system developed as a result of the Cuban Missile Crisis is a way to accomplish both goals. The football is designed to verify the president's identity using a code card called the Biscuit that the president carries at all times, while also allowing for near-immediate nuclear launch potential. Contrary to popular belief, the football does not actually contain a big red button for launching a nuclear war. Its primary purpose is to confirm the president's identity and allows him to communicate with the National Military Command Center in the Pentagon, which monitors worldwide nuclear threats and can order an instant response. The football also provides the commander-in-chief with a simplified menu of nuclear strike options.
Dear sir, we have choose from column A, column B, column C, or column D.
How many people would you like to die today?
Yeah. Allowing him to decide, for example, whether to destroy all of America's enemies in one fell swoop, or to limit himself to obliterating only Moscow or Pyongyang or Beijing. I'll have the super value meal. Let's supersize that.
Let's do it all at once.
How many warheads can I get? Put them all on 10. I mean, wait, this isn't.
I think I don't know the exact number, but it's not many. It's basically if this number of nuclear weapons goes off anywhere in the world, essentially all of humanity is doomed.
It depends on many factors.
It depends on many factors, but basically it'll throw up enough ash, create an ice age, and depending upon the nuclear weapon of choice, du jour, it could also send up enough nuclear or radioactive material that most of the world's population would succumb to radiation poisoning.
I do like the next two sentences. Mm-hmm. Dobbs, a former military aide to President Clinton, described the targeting options as a quote-unquote Denny's breakfast menu, allowing presidents to pick one target out of column A and two out of column B. A few ISIS-held cities here, a few Chinese nuclear silos there. President Donald Trump could order a nuclear strike about as easily as you or I could order a Grand Slam breakfast.
You know, a Grand Slam breakfast sounds pretty good right now. Because, yeah. Well.
She's going to eat all the donuts and have a bunch of 20 ice cream. February 2017 when he'd be inaugurated.
Yeah, it would.
March also, 2017.
To answer your question about how many it would take, roughly 100.
Only 100?
We've got about 2014
report published in the Journal of Earth Future found that even a regional war of 100 nuclear detonations would produce 5 teragrams of black soot. That's 100,000 million 5 billion kilograms. That would rise up into the Earth's stratosphere and block sunlight. This would produce a sudden drop in global temperatures that could last longer than 25 years and temporarily destroy much of the Earth's protective ozone layer. This could also cause as much as 80% increase in UV radiation to the Earth's surface, destroying both sea and land-based ecosystems, potentially leading to a global nuclear famine.
How to kill 6 billion people.
That does not make me happy.
And to give you, also, currently, the current U.S. nuclear arsenal is 4,500 warheads.
4,500. Oh. And I believe they're in the 20 kiloton range?
No, the standard detonation capacity is 222.
Kilograms or megatons?
Kilotons.
Kilotons?
No, we stopped using megaton weapons really post-Cold War because we realized there's... One, megaton weapons were designed when guidance systems weren't exactly the most accurate, so you want to have as big an explosion as possible. Now it's we could literally drop the dialable, they are dialable, 220 kiloton warhead on Vladimir Putin's, you know, yacht. We could do that.
Yeah.
So we don't need a city killer weapon. We are big on the idea of using capacity, small-scale tactical nuclear weapons, going, I want to kill that city block.
Baby nuke.
Because I can't.
Yep, they could send it down the chimney.
Yeah.
Oh. With the GPS guidance systems that we have today.
So there's that. So if you thought that the worst thing that Trump could do is maybe elect a couple judges, appoint them to the bench... no, there are worse
things.
We have
to live as a society long enough for those guys to do damage.
Yeah. He is expressing an interest in immediately destroying our enemies abroad by turning it to glass. Yeah. Radioactive glass.
Yep.
And he probably is unaware of that 100 figure. Though, with tactical nukes, they're much smaller, so your output may vary. Widely.
Yeah, your mileage may vary here, but it depends on also the reactions of other countries to our blatant aggression using nuclear weapons,
which has not
been done historically.
It's called MAD, Mutually Assured Destruction.
Yep.
That's all there is.
Also, to give you an idea, a really cool thing about how dialable our nuclear weapons are. The standard one, which we use nowadays, which is the B-61, has a blast yield everywhere between 0.3 to 340 kilotons.
Oh, 340.
That's crazy.
But you can dial it down to 0.3 kilotons.
Well, that'll make a really good size hole.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that's a little more powerful than a 2,000-pound dumb bomb.
Yeah.
Yep.
It's a nuclear weapon that can be dialed at that level, which is amazing.
Now, for a point of reference, Fat Man was 20 kiloton. Little Boy was 15 kilotons.
And they were also dirty bombs who actually exploded at ground level.
They were ground level.
I thought one of them was ground level. I thought the other one was airburst.
Maybe. I have to look that back up. But both of those were also fission weapons. Everything we have nowadays is a fusion weapon. And they are also almost all airburst.
Yes, which, for those playing at home, is the most devastating variety.
Yet the cleanest.
Yeah, because it doesn't come in contact with the media. It uses the effectiveness of the shockwave and the heat exchange created by the explosion to actually do the damage. So, yeah.
There's only so many suns that you can withstand in energy coming in your direction. Yeah. And then you become a shadow on the wall.
Yeah, I remember that whole scene from Terminator 2, Judgment Day, you know, or she's on the fence and then she's not on the fence anymore. Yeah, that's.
Oh, you mean like getting in my car in Florida? Gotcha.
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah. Except so that the skeletal structure would also be incinerated instantly.
Depends on the range.
It would just burn her all of her skin off.
Depends on the range. There is a toy that I found. I can't recall the address of that. Let's see, what was it? Nuke Map.
Yep, Nuke Map is amazing.
NuclearSecrecy.com/NukeMap. Nuke Map will allow you to drop a weapon in anywhere in particular that you like. Let me see here. Let me see if I can get all of this on screen, because it's cool.
Oh, good. You picked New York. I was going to suggest that.
It defaults to New York, believe it or not. No, it can't. I can't quite get everything in there. But anyway, Nuke Mac version 2.42. You can select a city. There are presets. Enter yield. There's also presets for those. So let's say, what was it? 340?
Yeah, 340.
That is the B-61. Yeah, the currently in the U.S. arsenal. And we can also have options for height of burst, air burst, or surface. Other effects, casualties, radioactive fallout. There's also advanced options.
Yeah, it'll show wind direction.
Yeah, and, you know, it'll show the rings of destruction all the way out, depending on what you want to know about that, about just how bad this is going to be. Like, dry wood usually burns. Show the thermal radiation for that. Because, yeah, if that's going to happen, then you're going to have forest fires and everything else. Everything's going to be on fire. Other effects.
All those wood houses.
Fireball, crater, humanitarian impact, fallout with the wind speed. Yeah, we'll add that one. And detonate. Bye-bye, Manhattan. Bye-bye.
Yep, Ground Zero is just completely vaporized and gone.
And let's see. Nah, this one, some of my plugins aren't working quite right, so I can't get all the effects in this one, unfortunately. So I can't show you where the fallout range is, but yeah, it's a decent size hole.
The first circle, I believe, is blast wave.
That
second
is the
circle, I believe, is
fireball. Fireball radius is the bright one in the center. Outside that is air blast radius at 5 psi. At 5 psi overpressure, most residential buildings collapse. Injuries are universal. Fatalities are widespread. Optimal height to of burst to maximize this effect is 2.18 kilometers. Thermal radiation burst is the last one in this particular one, and that is third degree burns. So this is where your skin stays on. But you are
blistered.
You are blistered very badly. You are not
just
a happy person.
Guys, the heat pulse travels near the speed of light.
That's right. Third-degree burns extend throughout the layers of skin and are often painless because they destroy the pain nerves. They can cause severe scarring or disablement and can require amputation. 100% probability for third-degree burns at this yield is 10.7... calcium? I don't know what that... Interesting. Yeah. So this detonation altitude was at the maximum for the air blast radius for 2.1 kilometers. Yeah. Chosen to maximize the 5 PSI damage range. Yeah, so that's a fun tool. I will put that link in our show notes so you can show your friends.
Don't forget the largest nuclear weapon ever detonated was the Tsar Bomba in Russia.
46 megatons?
52.
52 Jeez. Megatons.
It was dialable. They did not use it at its full yield. Its full yield was 100 megatons. They dialed it down to 52 for the test.
Yeah, it's kind of a big deal.
Why did they send it off? Oh, it was just a nuclear test.
That is what that does.
It was them showing hot. Basically, that was back in the days when it was Russia and the United States getting into a pissing match over who had the biggest, most powerful nuclear weapon.
There you go, gentlemen.
That's the actual thermonuclear weapon. They did that, and that's when we went, that's cute. We can drop 20 smaller ones and take you all out.
Do you see this blast radius? That is the Tsar Bomba, the 100 megaton variety. There's just no New York.
Yeah. The New York is literally a fireball.
Yep.
And the thermal radiation radius, it would burn people. It would also set a lot of things on fire in that entire region.
Well, the thermal radiation is, it goes from Long Island all the way to Lebanon.
Yeah, it's kind of a big deal. It almost reaches out to Trenton and Danbury. Yeah, it's it'd be bad.
Actually, at the very northern point, it stops just before it hits West Point. And at the southern point, let's see, do I see anything that's... it just covers Point Pleasant.
Nice.
No, it is no longer that pleasant in Point Pleasant.
No, not so much. So what about...
Hey, Six Flags Great Adventure is just outside.
Now, this is Tehran. If, of course, we were somehow dropping a 100 megaton explosion, you know, yeah. That'd
Which
be,
we could do.
We could.
We could.
We
why?
Could
do
that, yeah.
Don't ask questions why when you have a Trump.
Yeah, here's the 300 kiloton variety. Oh, that's a radiation radius on that one.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's not good.
See, that's the thing. With thermobaric weapons, with air fuel bombs or fuel air bombs, we don't even really need nukes.
50% and 90% mortality from acute effects alone.
Yep.
Dying takes between several hours and several weeks. Just give me a gun with one bullet in it at that point.
It's pretty bad. Pretty bad. So that's a good, fun toy, and I will put that under my picks. And, gentlemen, that pretty much wraps the show. What do you have? I see that, Stephen, you've got something there. The Sadie's A60 headset.
It is something I bought. I decided to finally get a better-end, higher-end gaming headset. I've never had a USB headset before. I finally have a USB headset. It comes in this lovely box. It's actually a pretty cool little box, I have to admit. I like the box.
Yeah.
But I like the fact that here's the headset. It is full around the ears.
Yes.
Okay. Yep. It also lights up.
Ooh.
Not just there, but here's the actual volume controller, mute. I can mute the speakers. I can mute the microphone. Full volume control, that lights up. The microphone, which I like, is here's the headset as it is. The microphone fully stows away.
That's nice.
Inside it. Sound quality, I haven't tested the mic yet. Sound quality wise, though, I've been playing Skyrim with this, and it is amazing. I can hear individual raindrops coming through. It is very effective as far as stereo, where you will hear something moving behind you, and it sounds like it's moving behind you.
Hmm.
So, I really enjoy these. They are incredibly comfortable. And they have a decent weight to them, and they feel sturdy, and it's padding all over
this thing
to make it very comfortable.
Let's try those next week, but I see that it has an omnidirectional microphone as opposed to the more classically unidirectional that we favor for what we're doing here.
I look forward to testing them out. Maybe I'll test them out before then to see what it's like in case, you know, screaming pain.
Oh, it'd be fine. We'll get over it. We'll get over it. So
they're only ears.
Amazingly, currently it's only $28 Amazon
That's
Prime.
That's what I got it for. That's from Amazon.com currently.
Wow.
And the thing is, I got it, is you look at the reviews, look at the number that is at the 4 to 5 star level, how many of the reviews. And it's over, the current number of reviews for our listeners out there, as I pulled up, 106 current customer reviews.
4.6 out of 5.
Yeah. Of which 86% are 4 star or higher.
Nice.
That is the math, yes.
That's where I went, okay, I'm willing to spend $27 to try this thing out.
Yeah, now it is only USB, so there is that.
Yeah, but it's full digital that way, which is, I'm learning now, is really nice.
Well, yeah, it can be, depending on what you're doing. I can't use it for what I'm doing here because I have too many inputs, and it would be its own unique thing, and Yeah. Unique little snowflakes.
More inputs, Andy?
No, unique little snowflakes in this environment are bad. They're bad.
So. You must have conformity.
But for gaming, fantastic. And for individual callers, also very good. All right, David, you got one again out of the Amazon.
Out of the Amazon, because this is, if you're into shooting sports, these are, the MSA sword is like the standard bearer for high quality hearing protection that also does other stuff. Basically, this is the stuff that our military special forces wears. And what makes these kind of special is that they do reduce the sound you hear when you fire a weapon. That's normal for powered hearing protection. And they do allow you to hear all the outside sounds that are there. What these do is they amplify quiet sounds and then cut out the loud sounds.
Ooh,
so
that's good.
People whispering, you'll be able to hear that. And they're currently $147 on Amazon. I'm going to be ordering those soon.
I'd be tempted to see how this works for hunting. Like, if you're up in a tree stand, you could just be scanning around with them. You could hear a deer or a bear or whatever else you're trying to hunt.
Crinkling over grass.
Going through the underbrush, yeah.
Oh, and it has an aux input, too.
Yes, this has an aux input, so you can hook it up to a radio and hear the radio through the headphones. Or MP3s. It'll accept anything, basically. And for $147, that's an incredible price. They have replacement ear cups that are actually gel-filled. So they're supposed to be extraordinarily comfortable. And those are $44. If you go down, should be the bundle that a lot of people get. So for $191, you can get the gel cups with foam inserts and really, really good hearing protection that is on par with the best that's out there.
Cool.
So if you want to protect your hearing and be able to hear crazy things, these are cool. This is part of my zombie/Trump apocalypse plan.
Indeed. Okay. So the MSA Sorten Supreme Basic with aux input and gray leather band electronic earmuff defenders hearing protection.
Yep. They're some of the lowest profile and also best overall. They run off of a couple AA batteries. I think there's something like 600 hours of usage you'll get out of them before the batteries die.
150.
Oh, okay. Never mind. 150.
AAA.
Or AAA batteries.
Yep.
Which are light and easy to store and carry with you everywhere.
And of course, known by the state of California, to probably cause cancer.
Like everything.
Because it is, yeah. So that's just the way it is.
The state of California is known by the state of California to probably cause cancer.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure that I'm known. Pretty sure I'm known by the state of California to cause cancer. Somehow. So noise reduction ratio is 18 dB, signal noise ratio 25 dB.
They make nice. Like Chinese knockoff versions, and those are like $70 to $80. But I mean, for double the price, you could get the real thing.
Cool. That's some good stuff. All right. Well, yep. Then.
On a side note, before we handle out.
Yes.
Thanks to you, I actually went to Elon Musk's Twitter.
Yeah.
And found the Gigafactory scale chart, which rates it in units of hamsters.
I'm sorry, what?
And the Gigafactory is apparently equivalent to 50 billion hamsters.
Hamsters.
Elon Musk has a sense of humor.
Hamsters, you say?
Hamsters.
Okay. Well, that's interesting. I don't know what to think about that, really. All right. Well, I think that will do it. Gentlemen, do you have anything else to share before we wrap?
I'm good.
Anywhere? Of course I still love you. USS, of course I still love you.
Ah, yes. I do like that one.
All of his stuff has a sense of humor to it, and that's one of the things I really love about Elon Musk.
Yeah, the USS, of course I still love you, is one of the drone recovery barges for the Falcon 9 single stage that comes back down. So, yeah.
Yep, he is dragging us kicking and screaming into the future whether we like it or not.
Mm-hmm. I like him.
Yeah, between Hyperloop and what he's going to do with Tesla Motors, the world is literally changing to his will.
Essentially, get on the bus or get left behind.
Yeah.
Well, you know, he's he's building Tesla buses to make it easier.
Oh, God.
Wait, did Jesus come back in a second coming as Elon Musk?
Doubtful.
Maybe.
Big doubtful there. All right. That's it. Here's the credits. All right. That's it for tonight. We'll be back live next Friday, barring any terrible unforeseen technical difficulties, about 9:30 p.m. Eastern. In the meantime, the conversations continue on the web. Head over to orlyradio.com. That's ORLYRADIO.com for all the links right at the top of the page. So you can like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, Tumblr, Google+, and subscribe to the YouTube and Twitch channels. Of course, you can watch us live and join in the fun in the chat, all from our webpage when it works. So very sorry about things tonight, but we'll fix it somehow. If you have stayed with us all the way through the credits, how about you give us a hand? If you have a few dollars to spare, you can contribute to the Patreon page and get early access to show releases, and we'll even get you some special perks here and there. Just follow the Patreon link on the webpage or go over to patreon.com/ORLYRADIO, ORLYRADIO. You can also make a one-time donation directly via the donate button. If you can't fit us into your rainy day funds, do us a solid, share the show, leave us a positive review, please, on whatever platform you found us on, preferably iTunes. And we're always looking for new ideas for the show. So how about you share what's on your mind with us? Shoot a note over to orlyradiopodcast@gmail.com. Or if you're the more talkative sort, we've got that phone number, 470-222-ORLY-6759. And it is always ready to take your call or your text. We can't thank you enough for joining us this evening, spending some time with us. And until next time, this has been ORLY Radio, part of the Cowen Services Network. Music for the show is created by Kevin McLeod of comtech.com. Thanks, everybody.
Goodbye.
Good night.
And it's in the can.
It's excellent. In the can.
Woohoo!